Salud, amigos,
friends, crew member of our beloved, polluted, and unique spacecraft, which, since the last time we met, has taken another turn about its imaginary axis and, of course, continues creating events in full development. Whenever you see me not standing up, it is because we have a guest, and today's guest is very, very interesting. And this is because of the topic that really affects me emotionally and is part of my pleasant and not so pleasant experiences. With us, Fernando Travieso, who's an economist, a master in political science, a constituent, a member of the Oil Subcommission that belongs to the Economy Commission, coordinator of the Socialist Observatory of the Bolivarian University of Venezuela. And this brings us also to the fact that there is currently a debate on the National Constituent Assembly and in the Congress of the PSUV about whether we are in a post-oil era or not. What a topic, what a topic to discuss. So it's better if you start with this topic. Well, it is a crucial topic because based on how you define your reality, the measures that you're going to take are going to be taken. So a mistaken diagnosis would be a very big mistake. In order to understand in depth, in order to diagnose what's happening based on this, we need to acknowledge that the quality of life of the human society is associated with their main source of energy used at a given point in time. So the wealth during the 19th century was conditioned on the energy capacity of carbon. Whereas the quality of life during the 20th century and during the 21st century is related to the energy quality of oil, particularly in the 19th century where aviation wasn't there yet and Navy forces were the crucial ones. Changing from carbon to oil was necessary. Yes, this is because carbon doesn't have the same quality to bring a piece of machine to fly. This can only be achieved with oil during the 20s, the 1920s. So you see the big difference between carbon and oil. So we can have divided opinions based on the stages by which recent human history has gone through, based on the main source of energy that has been used: wood, carbon, and then oil. So we all agree on this. And the world was happy with wood back then because it was an excellent type of fuel. However, we ran out of forest in Europe. And then the new wealthy people started using carbon. Carbon with a lot of sulfur. It was called lignite. And lignite did not allow for metals to be bound together. So when people cooked with lignite, they were actually getting sick due to sulfur. And then there was a war due to forest. So what Hollywood tries to sell us is a strategy for control of the population and of the new bourgeois, because if you control wood, you decide who's going to get sick and who isn't. And you're also going to see what's going to happen with the metal industry. So, for example, wood used to determine the growth of a city such as Rome, for example. Because looking for wood fire after many years, after using it in the city of Rome, it took more energy to look for wood than the energy wood would bring. So this was conditioning the growth of the cities. So there was a scarcity of wood, and lignite became to be the actual material used. And then an inventor in 1712 who invented the pump, because high quality carbon with low sulfur quantity is underground.
inundaban las minas, pues.
Nivel freático. And of course, the phreatic level was flooding the mines. Phreatic level. And with this pump, they were able to get water out, and they were able to extract good quality carbon. And this meant the industrial revolution. Without industrial revolution, we wouldn't have any factories, any salaries, any socialism, any capitalism or Marxism. It also defined the creation of a working class and a different aspect of contamination. Of course, and this is one of the research that we have brought to the observatory, and we have people who know a lot about Marxism, as Carlos Lasso, who investigated the speed of growth with carbon and without it. And I would also like to say hi to him. He is a very important character. So then, carbon age came in until in 1859, the first barrel of oil was drilled for oil in a well that was specifically meant for oil, and this happened in Pennsylvania. But however, geologists thought that oil was scarce, so they wanted to have security in their supply, so they would rather use it instead of oil because they did not have any security. Until they created this new invention, and with the new possibilities of gathering oil that were discovered, the world is starting using oil little by little. Until, well, the block of the Venezuelan coast, the coastline that is, of course, for oil. We should always speak about this, it's always necessary. The British war fleet sank our ships together with the German fleet, of course, endorsed by the United States and the whole world, just like today. And they were all against us because they wanted to take advantage. And we should make a call because I think that Cipriano Castro, thank God Commander Chavez was brought to the Pantheon. However, he should have a more relevant place instead of being at the floor of the Pantheon. I humbly ask, are we just expecting for the Queen of England to grant us permission or for the Kaiser to live again and allow us to take Cipriano Castro, because he was the one who defeated them, and then bury him in a place that he actually deserves? So then there was a change from carbon to oil, and Cipriano Castro didn't know that they were here for oil reserves. That the Shell company back then, because Royal Dutch Shell was born in 1907, and there was a follow-up of the National Mining Company, and that was the reason due to which the British influence was the one that has led us to state that the first well in Venezuela was Sumac, because then we're not related to the blocking of the Venezuelan coast, even though the first well was Eureka of 1983. So here you can concatenate the events, and in 1908, according to the Academy, the oil age started. So the stages between the wood era, the carbon era, and the current era are called transitions, and an energy transition can be due to two reasons. First, because you discover a new source of higher quality energy, or because you ran out of the other source of energy. And this is very important to understand. So when humans changed from carbon to oil, was because they found a new source of higher quality energy. And then you need to add all the research, and the world increase its population from 1 billion inhabitants to 7 billion. And you can understand what oil has meant for the improvement in life quality. So there is no substitute as of today for better quality energy. And this is what universities say, beginning with the studies of Professor Holland in the Public University of New York. As of today, we don't have any substitute of the same quality as oil. So when We started running out of oil reserves in 1981. Then, in 1981, for the first time, more oil was used than the one it was found. So this is when it started to run out. So as the trend continues, geology is a very difficult topic, and it's very difficult to estimate future behaviors. So when this trend kept on going, research started to see whether we are able to transform our means of production to a different source of energy. So if you substitute oil for net energy, so in this case, the amount of energy that you use with all the instruments like the drills and whatnot, with the rest of the other sources of information for gas, carbon, and mainly the renewable ones, then the difference is bigger. Gas cannot be storage in great capacities, and if they need to have this 160 degrees below zero, so change it into a liquid state. So if you have a strategic resource for this, then you have to spend more time keeping them than the energy you get from them. So there aren't any strategic reserves of gas, and it cannot be transported with trucks, for example. All renewable energies depend on oil. Globally, oil reserves are running out, and we do not have a substitute as of today. So we're going through a transition due to lack of a stock of the best quality, because we do not have a substitution that has the best type of quality. So as of today, there's a concentration of geopolitical tensions that I've never seen before in the history of humanity. That's why no one better than you, who has followed up for so many years the events in humanity, and now you can see the events taking place out today. There is a president in the United States who's speaking ill about Germany, that are building a gas pipeline through the Baltic in order to avoid the toll in Poland, and then he speaks against the Poles, the Polish, for being near Russia, and depends on the contacts of Russia in order to be and controlled by his own intelligence that is controlled by other groups. We would need to confirm whether the Deutsche Bank was actually the one who bought two brands of La Polar, Harina Pan and Cerveza Polar. These are flour and beer products. So there are two big German producers. Germans are always there. However, Vanguard is ahead. So Vanguard, if this is true, this can be seen on the media. We've seen that the Deutsche Bank and Vanguard has more control over the Deutsche Bank, that now faces a lot of problems. However, it's too big to fail. So with their branch, which is the Deutsche Bank of Canada, they bought Harina Pan and the beer brand, La Polar. This is what they say. But now we're facing a transition because we're running out the best quality source. We do not have any substitute. The sources of renewable energies were investigations of the companies that produce oil, because when you run out of oil, there are areas that you will not be able to supply. So for them, in order to keep the business, they produce renewable energy, they create them in order to take over these market niches. However, from a geopolitical perspective, the countries that don't know about reality are told that oil is going to be kept underground. Just sell a part of your company, and with the money I give you, you should build wind and solar energy that are also mine. So they simply close the cycle. But this is what they did with Saudi Arabia, for example. And this is cruelly realistic. Absolutely. And Saudi Arabia was a great power. What happened with them? Well, they were able to convince the people by telling them that oil was going to be kept underground because renewables are coming. That's why they needed to sell a part of their country to the big investors of the world. And the government of Saudi Arabia, the monarchy with the Congress of the United States, that drafted a law that stated that those who have lost a family member on the Twin Towers attack, they could set a lawsuit on Saudi Arabia because they were the ones who financed this. So Machiavelli wasn't enough for this. Yes. This is even worse than that. Okay, but we are covered. We do have follow-up. And sometimes we're even ahead. And with President Chavez, we were able to defeat them. And then he was all in, right? Yes, that's why President Maduro gave it the name. All strip of Orinoco, Hugo Chavez Frías, for it to be clear. Because they are here to take over this strip for all the reasons. Because this strip is the one that keeps the stocks throughout the planet. Listen, there's a technical figure called on-site oil, and this is underground oil, but only a percentage of this oil can be extracted in a profitable way, and this is a reserve. Reserve is not all the underground oil, it's only a percentage that can be extracted while being profitable. So this is the recovery factor, and it's 20%. Our partners, for example, right now with Ayacucho Block 2, we're speaking about a given number of barrels to support the central bank. If it's 5.8 billion barrels, because only 20% of on-site oil has financial value. So the excellent policy that Maduro has as of today with his great team, well, then we need to add and state humbly that there aren't almost 30 billions, but almost 6, because only 20% is the recovery percentage. Could you clarify this, please? Listen, in the oil strip, there are 29 billion barrels. All right. So there's 1 trillion, 1.3 trillions. Okay. So this is madness. Out of this total, only 20% are considered reserves. Okay. This adds up from the certificates you have today, 261 billion barrels. So based on the recovery percentage, the 20%, we have this number. So on block one, which is the one that supports the petro, there are almost 5.4 billion barrels, a great amount. This is the same amount that transnationals have throughout the rest of the planet. That's what they have left. And this is only block one of the Ayacucho in the Orinoco oil strip in the south of the Anzoátegui state. On block two, the decree adds up to 29 billion barrels, but the financial value is only 29%. It's only 20% because that's the recovery percentage. So the international financial world endorses that 20% of underground oil can be extracted in a sustainable fashion that is profitable. And now everyone has turned their eyes to Venezuela. Of course they have, without a doubt.
La contraparte de manera so
what is the counterpart trying to do in a very sophisticated way? Confusing people who walk in good faith, to confuse them with renewable energies, with this and whatnot. And then they told us that this oil was already almost out and we should pay them to get rid of it. When the Sarbanes-Ossi law was approved in 2002 by the Congress of the States and started being executed in 2004, this forces all companies that are part of the stocks of the States to certify their assets. They're forced to do so. So the Commission of Stocks and Values, this is mandatory for them, adapted this to the gas and oil industry. So then they created regulations to certify an oil company. to understand how much it is worth, and exclusively certified reserve, not even their cash flow. So, it wasn't enough for transnational companies to have this in the strip. Only what is considered oil according to the American Petroleum Institute, that according to an API encompasses all the big transnational companies that work in the States, the biggest lobby of the world. This is the name of the oil lobby, Walter. American Institute of Oil. But it is such a strong lobby that it creates technical knowledge and spreads it. People here are indeed warriors, and then they are recycled. I visited the Texas University for a course that I had there, and they show you what they want to show you. They give you a beautiful postcard, however, they never tell you what you're saying right now. If you had the bitumen name in the strip, they couldn't register as future production, this reserves. So they are the parties that are wanting to have this cold oil. And this was good for us, actually. But it is even better for them. However, the one who was the former director of PDVSA, and when they showed the lack of knowledge of oil, a full lack of knowledge of the things that were happening there, then they told us, we have defeated transnational companies. We changed the name from bitumen to oil, because transnational companies were the ones who say that if they don't call it bitumen, they cannot take it to the future, and they cannot support the Venezuelan Constitution, where the Republic is the owner of hydrocarbon research. So this is important, because the rival that we're facing right now is the global oligarchy, hand by hand with Kissinger. So there are people who have a great intellectual capacity. They're very smart. So what they were able to hide, well, they told us that we were defeating transnational campaigns. And they showed us their great weakness, and their weakness is that they are running out of reserves. They're running out of oil reserves. Is this making them dangerous? We are at the verge of an enormous conflict. That's why President Chavez brilliantly created mixed companies. To be clear about this, a mixed company is a creation of law firms of transnational companies, so that legally global reserves, because they're running out those that are kept in the States, can record this as future production. And then President Chavez, with a strike and with the world against them, they killed them with the world against them. He said, okay, but 60% of the stocks belong to the Venezuelan state. And this created friction. And Mr. Tillerson took ExxonMobil out of the country, and the stockholders created then Vanguard, because they lost their money in one of the companies. So President Chavez says this perfectly clear. He gave his life for this, and he knew that they were here for the strip. And he said that 60% of mixed companies should and must be undoubtedly property of the Venezuelan state. That's why he said the difference between the capital of the Venezuelan state and foreign investors or private national and foreigners should be big enough so that no one can doubt Venezuela's sovereignty. That's why it's so important to have a definition. So as a recap, we are carrying out a transition due to a lack of further reserves in a transition for new sources, sources that have a lower quality. That's why the whole world is not taking this leap, because this would mean an increase of poverty globally. And this is what they want to hide from us, because the energy quality of all other sources is below the one of petroleum. So we are not going through this area, because we do not have a substitute. It's going to be the source with the greatest quality that we know as of now in history. And carbon, even though oil is far superior than it. Regardless of how much time has gone by, it is even more important than gas in the generation of electricity. So, let us not swap mirrors for gold. We are back in a situation that sets that at the point of interest that are not the best, and we should be very well prepared for events that at some point will want to hit us again. And they have tried to do so. They have tried with every means possible. 30 seconds and we will have a break. Today, when I saw the strike of the farmers that was welcomed by the president that were showing the problems with the administration, well, this is not the first time that there is an infiltration of foreign interests in our administration. It's the basic 101 of the fourth generation war, to infiltrate public administration of the enemy to make it operational. We know this. We're not creating something new. So we need to be clear about the facts that are taking place. This is a transition where, due to lack of oil reserves, we do not have any source that can substitute it. And that's why there is so much conflict on the oil strip of Orinoco that is going to increase little by little. That's why there was an invasion in Iraq. That's why Libya was bombed. That's why Libya was destroyed. Two countries that are continuing in a civil war. They want to invade Iran, but they aren't able to do so yet, because when they close, they thought that they were going to have control over Syria to create a pipeline for oil, not for gas, and this is to get the production of Iraq. And this is the main artery for oil, like 40% of oil that is exported. My dear Fernando Travieso, it's been a real pleasure. All your information will be enjoyed in another show. You are always an important guest for this program, and we take ownership of your concept because we believe in them for the present and the future. Thank you very much. Thank you and all of your team. We're going to have a short break, and we will be back with more events in full development. We'll be right back.
Volvemos con más acontecimientos en pleno desarrollo.
We are back with more events in full development. Satélites. I am checking my satellites, and there are a lot of events going on.
Como es nuestra costumbre,
but as we often do,
los acontecimientos
we're going to take a look
desarrollo.
At the events fully development throughout the world.
Con una situación
today's
más
events
fluida,
are related
les informaremos de inmediato.
To the events that we're going to let you know about immediately. What we have here, the United Nations Agency for Refugees, it says that there are 19,000 victims of massive displacement in Colombia. The United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees for refugees states that this amount has already topped the amount of the ones in 2017. The system to strengthen early alert systems on the Ombudsman Office of Colombia, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees created an alert for the massive displacement that has taken place in the country throughout the last months. This is a crime against humanity. It's a global event that should be taken into consideration.
Jos Merckx
stated during his first semester in 2018 that at least 19,000 people have been displaced in massive events. During the presentation of the agreement to strengthen the early alert system of the Ombudsman Office of Colombia, the UN HCR created a warning about the massive displacement of the country during the last months. The representative of the organization in Colombia, Joseph Merckx, stated that during the first semester of 2018, at least 19,000 people have been forcibly displaced in massive events. I quote, during 2017, only 15,000 people were displaced. Then emphasizing that this year's number is above the one of the year before, and measures must be taken to avoid this type of violence that forced population to leave their own land. Merckx stated that the most affected regions are the borders with Ecuador, Panama, and Venezuela. The Department of Antioquia in the Catatumbo region of Santander showed that there has been an increase of the internal displacement due to violence, due to which he said that these are high indicators that are concerning.
Bueno, palabras proféticas, ¿no? En la carta de Jorge Glass como vicepresidente,
Jorge Glass's letter as a vice president one year ago,
según La Nación,
Rafael Correa, former president, remembers in his tweet according to La Nación. What we have here, the former vice president of Ecuador claimed
entrega de medios
alliances with Bucaram,
paquetazo, entre
and
comillas,
public media
de cifras
making
y
or
de
made private as well as other corruption
2017,
events. On August 2nd, 2017, the vice president of Ecuador, Jorge Glass, had a letter where he mentioned that the return of the old country was being orchestrated with corruption and
his
words could lead to threats and other political trials. And former President Rafael Correa said this, prophetic words, he said. One year ago, as the Vice President of Ecuador, Jorge Glass, addressed this letter to the country. Every Ecuadorian should read it, prophetic words. Today, he is in jail.
Ni siquiera 20 centavos mal habidos.
However,
mientras que los saqueadores del país han vuelto al
none
poder,
of the charges against him have been proven.
Esto lamentó el
this is what Correa, the former president Rafael Correa has said
de su ex compañero de fórmula.
By
ahora,
also
ahora
speaking
Glass,
about the former letter.
Correa.
Now this is Jorge
no
Glass quoted by Correa.
Callado.
I cannot be
más.
Silenced, I cannot wait any longer, even though President Lenin Moreno requested me to do so when I rejected
Bucaram,
the appointment of people of the Bucaram family in key positions of the government. He acknowledged so and asked me to wait. He said that he was going to solve it, that he needed some time. But time has run out. The nation cannot waste any time. These were the words of the former vice president of Ecuador. This is lanacion.com.es.
Primero,
Amongst the claims mentioned by Glass, alliances with the Bucaram family by giving them the CNEL, National Commission of Electricity. Secondly, give the public media to representatives of the public of the private media, manipulating the economic figures by creating a false mismanagement of the economy, and also claims of corruption of members of Correa's government. This is what Glass said in his letter.
Compañeros, yo soy un hombre de principios y valores.
I am a man of principles and values. No one is going to silence me.
A mí no me van a callar.
No one is going to silence me.
Fraguar informes de Contraloría,
they can create any reports or request any trial or want to take me to jail without any proof.
No me van a callar.
But they will not shut me up.
Miedo.
I am
no
not afraid. I will not be silenced.
I
will never betray my people. Here I am, showing my face, defending my people. This is what Glass said in his letter.
Y sigue comentando lanacion.com.
And lanacion.com added the following. Currently, the vice president is in jail number 4 of the city of Quito, sentenced to 6 years in prison.
Y para este programa dossier,
for dossier program,
presunto delito de asociación,
the alleged crime of illicit association within the investigation of the Other Bridge case. Other Bridge has, of course, created disasters throughout every country they've been. The penal room of the Court of Justice notified the denial to the appeal after Glass's lawyers are going to intervene with a resource. This resource is not a third instance, and he will not speak about the possible accusation of Jorge Glass that eventually will speak about the second instance's defects, and are going to send this to a second instance court in order to have a different decision made, but according to the doctrine of the annulment court. Based on the words of President Correa, Jorge's Glass trial would be impossible in a state of law. Remember that he is in jail even though no charges have been proved, while the people of Other Bridge haven't even been accused of this. Long live corruption.
LaNación.com
adds, Rafael Correa is also being investigated within the case of alleged kidnapping of the politician Fernando Valda, a very important case, and has been linked with this case. He has
been
chased by the Interpol because the former president lives in Belgium. In the country,
la JPM.
There's also a cause against him. LaNación.com has the following sources. Rafael Correa's Twitter account and EcuadorInmediato.com, because there are a lot of things at stake here. And based on this, I would like to add something because we have some interesting events here. Ecuador's courts denied the resource of appeal to the former Vice President Jorge Glass. The National Court of Justice of Ecuador denied the appeal
acusado por supuesta asociación ilícita en el caso de Brecht.
Need by Jorge Glass with Other Bridge. By this decision, the court reinstates the 4 years of jail, 6 years of jail against President, former Vice President Glass. This is a penal code that is compared with a different code that is not enforced, that didn't.
Así que compañero, a toda Latinoamérica,
well, match the
no permitan la judicialización
so
de la
don't
política.
Allow
el pasado 23 de mayo se dio trámite a la apelación solicitada por el ex vicepresidente. En la sustentación, la defensa aseguró que se lo sentenció con un código derogado. Por lo tanto, este hecho determinaba la nulidad e inconstitucionalidad del proceso.
The process was inconstitutional according to his defense. The sentence stated today in appeal is completely null. There are reasons, there aren't any rational reasons behind this, as the parameters required by the Constitutional Court of Ecuador and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. The National Justice Court, by denying this, reaffirmed the 6 years of prison against the former vice president on the Odebrecht case. His lawyers are looking for new instances that would allow this sentence to be overthrown. Of course, we are not satisfied with the result, and based on the framework of the law, we're going to propose, when notified, the annulment resource, and then continue with our actions, the ones that we are rightful for, with the Constitutional Court and the international organizations. In the meantime, the outside of the Constitutional Court of Quito saw problems that show the lack of conformity based on the decision taken by the court against the former vice president.
Aquí lo que tenemos es que se tramitan las medidas cautelares en la Corte Interamericana de Derechos Humanos a favor de Correa y Glass.
For Correa and Glass.
Varios activistas políticos de Ecuador confirmaron que la CIDH ha aceptado a trámite las medidas cautelares a favor de Jorge Glass y Rafael Correa.
The measures against Jorge Glass and Correa. Political activists in the Montecristi collective mentioned that the Inter-American Court of Human Rights have accepted the paperwork for the request in order to dictate interim measures for the constitution of Lenin Moreno without the constitutional court's authority and also the appointment of control authorities. As part of the request, well, we don't have a video, but we have pictures, and as part of the request, they add in this case that former Vice President Jorge Glass, who requested his legitimate right to defense, requesting an inter-American process. The Inter-American Court of Human Rights has accepted the paperwork of request in order to dictate into measures for the public consultation of Lenin Moreno without the authority of the Constitutional Court and then the appointment of the institution members of authority. The principle of legality has been broken in our country. Thus, the citizens no longer have a law that governs the fulfillment of our rights. As part of this request, it is mentioned that in the case of the former Vice President Jorge Glass, his legitimate right to defense was affected, going against the duly process, and they request inter-American protection for him. It is necessary in order to exercise the right of any citizens, and for this, the rights of the former Vice President Jorge Glass has been attacked, and this is what we're requesting within the request of interim measures. This paperwork that has been accepted in the inter-American level includes interim measures for former President Rafael Correa, and there's a political prosecution for them. No one can be discriminated when defending the rights in any instance.
Correa, a su vez, dijo, tengo
Correa
una orden
added,
de arresto por la injusticia ecuatoriana.
Because of lack of justice in Ecuador,
no es un estado de derecho y que el fiscal fue puesto a dedo solo con el objetivo de encarcelarlo a él.
Prosecutor
el exmandatario de Ecuador, Rafael Correa, se pronunció tras la orden de prisión preventiva dictada este martes en su contra por la jueza ecuatoriana Daniela Camacho,
that was requested by Judge Daniela Camacho for his link with the former,
no
the kidnapping
es que yo tengo
of the
una orden
former
de por la justicia ecuatoriana. Tengo una orden de arresto
politician
por la injusticia
Balda.
Ecuatoriana.
Said, I am
Ecuador
not wanted
no es un
because
derecho,
of the justice of Ecuador.
Correa,
I am wanted because of the injustice of Ecuador.
RRT,
Ecuador is not a state of
cadena.
Law. And he said this during an interview
Ecuador
in RT.
No es un estado de
Ecuador is not
mire,
a state of law.
Concreta,
listen,
no
there are some
mí,
very
pregunte,
concrete events. Don't trust me, just ask. What is the legal framework by which the prosecutor was appointed? What's the legal framework by which the district attorney was appointed? This is not legal. This is just appointed without any type of context, just to send me to jail. What's the constitutional framework in order to include these people and take out the former people, the one in charge of all the justice system, the judges, the ombudsman, and others? And they were arbitrarily taken away. And instead of being replaced, they were just appointing my political enemies. So I am not wanted by justice in Ecuador, but by injustice in Ecuador. Ecuador is not living in a state of law. If this would have happened in my country, in my government, we would be in the international, the Hague court. This makes no sense. It's ridiculous and has no perspective of success internationally. However, based on the state of things in Ecuador, where anything is valid just to go against us. They're speaking about a so-called kidnapping. He was 20 or 30 minutes. Well, yes, he could have been kidnapped. This person who was fleeing from justice in Ecuador, he was in Colombia legally carrying out illegal things in Colombia by selling IT equipment and illegal equipment as well. That this is a police abuse. Some officers captured him, and they wanted to involve the president of Ecuador with false testimony. And just the abuse of the police is related to the president. This makes no sense, and internationally it will never be successful. However, in our country they try to humiliate us and to avoid us from getting to our country. I read the alert with the Interpol to make us look as criminals. However, I think that the Interpol will reject this because how clearly evident politically this is in a case. If this would have happened in my government with a political opposition, they would be in the Hague. If Lula's event would happen in Venezuela, then Venezuela would already be invaded. There are double standards for this, and we need to stop this lawfare. We need to stop politics to take over the courts. Lenin Moreno states that Julian Assange will have to abandon at some point the embassy of Ecuador. President of Ecuador, Lenin Moreno, in a meeting with journalists in Madrid, stated that the founder of WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, will need to leave the embassy of Ecuador in the United Kingdom through different dialogue mechanisms with other parties. And the former president of Ecuador, Rafael Correa, has mentioned the importance of ensuring a resolution process for this particular case. Julian Assange requests government help from Australia. This happened during his European tour, particularly in the city of Madrid, where he was in a forum with other journalists, and during this tour, he also visited the United Kingdom. This also raised the expectations based on the decisions that could be made about the WikiLeaks founder. Let us remember that he offers for the first time in public that Julian Assange will eventually have to leave the embassy, that the political asylum will have to be over. This cannot go forever. There should be an end at some point. Yes, but this should be done through dialogue. If we say that dialogue is the best mechanism for approach and understanding, then we should be the ones that practice this at first. The Ecuadorian president also stated that Julian Assange carries out activities he doesn't agree with, even though he believes that his information is relevant. However, leaving the embassy should be guaranteed by stating that his life is not at risk. This was affirmed by President Moreno. I have never agreed with Julian Assange's activity. I have never agreed with his interventions, with private emails of people in order to get information, even though this information could be valuable, in order to shed some light on the government and people. This is not the way to do so. There are right ways and lawful ways to do so. However, the previous government, this is a problem we inherited. The former government thought that Julian Assange's life was at risk. Ecuador doesn't have penalty of death, and we were aware of this possibility. So the only thing that we want is the guarantee that his life will never be at risk.
paso de Lenín Moreno por el Reino Unido ha levantado muchas expectativas y también trascendió en la prensa que podría haber novedades al respecto del futuro de Julian Assange con el asilo político que tiene en su embajada de Ecuador aquí en la ciudad de Londres. Igualmente, y a pesar de todo esto, hay que tener en cuenta que durante todos estos días la situación se dio en forma normal. Hay una guardia periodística al igual que constantemente en el resto de los días, constantly, just like in the rest of the days, and the movement in the embassy has been the same one as the one in any other month. However, there's a lot of attention with the talk that the Ecuadorian president states that holds with the authorities of the United Kingdom in order to look for a way to take Assange out of the embassy.
Julian Assange requests help to the government of Australia,
and Australia must protect him because he's an Australian citizen, according to Assange's lawyer.
WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange
has requested the government of Australia to work by his side, based on possibly being expelled from the embassy of Ecuador in London, where he is since 2012. Intercept news portal published last week that Ecuador will eventually and imminently take away the state of refugee that Assange holds in London. Assange's lawyer explained that she's very concerned about him.
He is still
an Australian citizen and he has the possibility of requesting protection and law.
Here is my son, journalist Mrs. Julian Assange.
Christine Assange.
Aquí está mi hijo,
here is
el
my son, journalist Julian
Assange,
hard at work, getting the document truth
sobre
about
el poder
corrupt power out to the people. That's why he's
y aquí
been
a Unity for
prosecuted
J.F.
politically.
Francis.
This is Unity
amordazar
for J.F. Francois.
A uno es amordazar a todos.
Tying one down is tying everyone down.
Es parte
and
de
this
los
is, of course,
de
part of the statements of different media as well
en
as different possibilities.
Francis,
Unity for J. Francois.
Atención al mundo y embajada de
attention
Estados Unidos,
world and embassy
si
of the States.
If
Assange is expelled.
Eso es lo que dice allí. Y atención mundial
and
de urgencia.
Also worldwide
después,
attention urgently.
Si acaso, los Estados Unidos
if the United States
expulsan, a ese pulsado y Estados Unidos
him,
mete aquí algo en bolsa, ¿no?
Here.
Hay una opción ahí.
There's an option here.
Y en este sentido,
based on this,
la posibilidad de lo que estamos viendo, esto es
so
de España, edición de fines de facilitar la lectura, casi al mismo tiempo en que el presidente de Ecuador, Lenín Moreno, aterrizaba en Londres, su Secretaría de Comunicación emitía una nota desde Quito para desmentir que el asunto Assange está incluido en la agenda oficial.
In order
el mandatario
to
inicia el lunes una serie de actos en el Reino Unido enfocado principalmente en la cumbre mundial
activity
de discapacidades y no dará espacio en su gira para abordar la condición del fundador de WikiLeaks que lleva asilado en la embajada ecuatoriana de Londres desde el año 2012. El desmentido responde a una información publicada en un medio británico donde se asegura
on
con
a British media that ensures with the basis of an international source that he was going to take advantage of his international visit to expel Assange from his embassy. The executive
no
reaffirmed that Assange is not part of the plans of the president of Ecuador,
and
at no point it was mentioned that the president is going to visit the embassy of London where Julian Assange has been for 6 years.
Que tras la llegada de Lenín Moreno a la presidencia se han visto amenazadas las conquistas sociales logradas en los últimos años por la revolución ciudadana.
Have been a threat that have been achieved by the social revolution. We are protesting because Lenín Moreno has been invited to represent people in Ecuador. However, he is taking steps back from all the years that we progressed with the citizen revolution. He's after the leaders of our country, Rafael Correa, Jorge Glass, and now betraying what Ecuador
when we accepted the political asylum, Julian Assange had stated, we are here to say that the person here, that the one who is our president, has now become a traitor. He is not welcome in our country, that we are against him, against everything he's doing with our country. We do not agree with the way in which he's governing the country. We don't agree how he's delivering the country only to rich people. He was elected for a reason, to help the poor, and he's doing the exact opposite. He's trying to privatize all the companies in Ecuador, and we're not going to allow this to happen. We're here to show him that from every corner where an Ecuadorian is, we're not going to allow this to happen. We were the ones who brought him to the presidency, and we're going to take him away from it. He should not be doing things that he should not be against our president, Rafael Correa, who started all this work for the great president called Ecuador. We're going to show our rejection to the rest of the world. The whole world needs to know that this is a traitor. This is the verified account at WikiLeaks, which has got this information about the events taking place there.
WikiLeaks retweeted
Ecuador's chancellor.
Canciller ecuatoriano.
The Ecuadorian chancellor. It is for the interest of Ecuador and also for Mr. Assange for his asylum to end.
Vamos a traducir del inglés.
We're going to translate this from English. It's in the best interest of Ecuador and also Mr. Assange for this asylum to end, but always under the framework of international law and dialogue with the United Kingdom. We do not consider that this is a feasible unilateral decision. Canciller at valencia.ec.ecuador, July 31, 2018. So, as you can see, our beloved polluted and unique spacecraft continues creating events in full development. And we have shown you a lot of events, very important. This is just a part of all the news that we needed to bring to hierarchy and speak about it. So, after our unique and only spacecraft has taken our time with Mary Actions, we'll be back here showing you the next big story of the next 24 hours. In the meantime, from Studio 3 of Venezuela Televisión, VTV, the Doyen channel of Venezuelan television, I here say goodbye to you. My name is Walter Martínez. I'm the host or producer of Dossier. Thank you for having us to be there with you. Director, the floor is all yours.